इंद्रो विश्वस्य राजति।
नमस्ते। इन आवर वेदास आवर ग्रेट सीयर्स हैव रिवील्ड द ट्रूथ इन वेरियस फॉर्म्स। ईच वेदा हैज ए महावाक्य एंड दीज महावाक्यास आर नथिंग बट द रिविलेशंस ऑफ द सीयर्स about their inner experience of the truth, and the truth is about the Parabrahman, the Lord of this universe. We call him with different names. We call him God, we call him Bhagwan, we call him as a deity, Parabrahman, so many different names, but we must understand the truth behind these Mahavakyas. For example, take this Mahavakya which says Prajnanam Brahma. Prajnanam Brahma. So this statement, this Mahavakya is telling that Prajna is Parabrahman. We must understand what is Prajna. And then we will be able to understand the true form of this Parabrahman, the truth about this Parabrahman. Consciousness is the basic substratum of this universe. Consciousness is everything. That's what this Mahavakya is telling us. So now let us look at this Prajnanam. What is this word Prajnanam? Look at me now. I am driving. I am saying that I am driving. Please understand and underline this word, I am. I am saying that I am driving. But closely observe me. And also you can closely observe your activities, your everyday activities. While talking, my body is also performing an action. And to perform any action, we need consciousness. Only conscious beings can do actions which are meaningful. So, when we are doing an action, the consciousness is actually doing all this, but we claim it as I am doing. So, who is this I am? What is this I? This is the identity. Identity of something. So we are taking the identity of I am, we are borrowing this from something else. Let us go deeper into this. Consciousness is called as Prajna. The trinity of this consciousness in Vedas, the words that are used for this are Prajnanam, Jnanam, Vijnanam. So Prajnanam is the pure consciousness. Jnanam is the ability to know, so which is intelligence. And Vijnanam is the knowledge, knowledge of the external objects, the subjective knowledge, Vishaya Jnanam. Please understand the differences between these three states. It is the same consciousness, but we say Prajnanam, Jnanam, Vijnanam. So many people misinterpret the Prajnanam Brahma Mahavakya and they say knowledge is Parabrahman. No. Knowledge is not Parabrahman. But when you go deeper and experience, maybe yes, we can say yes, knowledge is also Parabrahman. But the true meaning of this Prajnanam Brahma is pure consciousness is Parabrahma. Knowledge actually refers to learning something. So it is the subjective and objective information that we gain by using the intelligence, Jnanam. Jnanam is the ability to learn, to know. So when you don't understand the true meaning of the words, you will mistake these Mahavakyas and think that learning is Parabrahma. No. What should we learn? We should learn about our own self. So, this experience that we are getting in this state of vijnanam, knowledge, is actually gained by an agent. Someone is learning something, but who is this I, which is in all of us, and claiming that it is learning, it is doing, it is performing all these actions? So, now look at me. I decided that I will drive, and also decided that I will speak to you simultaneously. I am doing multitasking. Now my mind is engaged in doing an action, and also it is concentrating on the words that I am speaking now. To do all these actions, there should be a conscious agent which is continuously flowing, undivided consciousness. Only then all these actions can happen. Even in your sleep, you are conscious. But you are conscious of what? So, human beings understand that when they are awakened, when they illumine the world, when they use the power of intelligence, they will observe all the objects and gain information about the objects, and they think that it is really the waking state. But in fact, we are mistaken about this idea about ourselves. Our consciousness is undivided flow. It is like the screen on which all these objects are projected. So, what is this screen and who are projecting these objects on the screen and who is learning about these objects? When you closely understand this experience now, will also teach us that it is the consciousness which is doing all these things, but there is an agent who has arisen in between and claiming that he is in fact doing all these actions. An interruption is happening here to the flow. Recently, one of my coaching friends, he called me, and when we were discussing about the behavioral theories and the research about this behavior by the behavioral scientists, he named a very beautiful scientist and the theory called as flow, F-L-O-W. Csikszentmihalyi. I hope I pronounced the name correctly. Sorry if I'm wrong. This guy has revealed a theory by name of flow. What is this state of flow? When you do, there are so many people in us who engage in mental activity and who create. For example, designers, programmers, coding, painters, sculptors, and for example, housewife who stands in the kitchen and cooks. When you closely observe your activities like this, you will understand. You will also realize that the action is actually happening spontaneously and automatically. Mind is actually deciding that it will do an action, and the rest is performed automatically, just like this driving. I don't have to think that I have to press brake when there is a vehicle ahead, or I need to use my clutch, accelerator. My body is performing this action spontaneously and automatically. And it is deciding what to do and what not to do. These eyes, ears, everything have an attention now paying on this road and the vehicle. At the same time, this consciousness is also helping me to speak with you and also speak meaningful words that make a real meaning about the concept that we are discussing now. If there is no consciousness, this capability of intelligence, the power of intelligence, and this learning will not happen. So what is prajnanam? Prajnanam is the pure consciousness, untainted consciousness. Take the example of this sun. The sun is giving brilliance to the entire world, but he doesn't have the feeling that he is illumining this world, that he is doing this action of absorbing the water from the earth and storing it in the clouds, and when the time is right, showering back the water on the earth, this Srishti Yajnam, this is happening. But what our rishis say? It is a selfless work. So there is no I in it. So the state of flow, what we are talking about, is achieved when this agent in between, that is the one who is thinking that I have the capability to do things, when he subsides, when he takes rest, everything will happen automatically. The Vedic mantras, the ruks, that the great seers revealed to us in the Vedas, these Vedic suktas are an inner darshan of the rishi in a state of flow. That is called a state of flow. So what is this flow? Uninterrupted consciousness is in fact doing all these things. But when you look at me, you will say, Madhav is driving and also speaking. But you are identifying this body, because you will see these lips moving, these hands working, and you will say that he is working, he is talking. But who is talking here? It's not this body. This body is only a machine. Whatever is inside is being produced by this body, and whatever is projected here is nothing but a decision, is an energy flow which is being flowing from heart to your head. Bhagavan Raman Maharshi says that in fact all the beings use this power of consciousness, but they don't realize that it is the consciousness which is doing. It is because of the mistaken identity in all of us. We refer to ourselves as a body. And when we confine this consciousness to a body, it will act as if it is a body. Understand? To make it more meaningful, I will tell a very beautiful experience of my great master, my grandmother. My grandmother was she is very innocent. She didn't get proper education. I'm talking about 1940s, I think. She is just 13-year-old girl, but she wanted to do meditation and yoga. My grandmother used to stay in East Godavari district of Andhra Pradesh. So one day, she went all the way to Thuni, a place called as Thuni, to meet a lady who is called as Raja Yogi. She went there and asked her to give a mantra so that she can recite this mantra to attain liberation. The Raja Yogi said, Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya. That's all. She didn't speak anything more than that. She said, Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya. My grandmother was so innocent that she thought it is a very great Mahamantra that the Raja Yogi gave. She came back to Samalkot. She started reciting this mantra. And you will not believe me, just within few months, she reached highest state of meditation. The meaning, she doesn't even know the meaning of it. Brahma Satyam means Parabrahman is the truth. Jagat, this ephemeral world, is the ephemerality. It will destroy. It is not going to stay permanently. So this is just nothing but mithya. This is illusion. So when she started reciting this Mahamantra and started doing meditation, her conscious mind grasped the meaning of this Vakya and enabled her to reach a state of highest meditative state. Then why I told this is, you must understand that your mind is having the capability of creating anything that you firmly believe. That's what Swami Vivekananda also says. And Dakshinamurti also tells us in Dakshinamurti Stotram, Vishwam Darpana Drushyamana Nagari Tulyam Nijantargatam. This world is nothing but objects which are reflected in a mirror, and that mirror is nothing but your mind. So whatever you want to create, you have the capability of creating whatever you want to create when you firmly believe that it is the consciousness in you which is doing all these things. Then there is no interruption, then there is no negative talk, then there is no interference. When you leave it to the consciousness, it happens spontaneously and automatically. Look at your example or look at your experience. When you are quoting something, you get grossly engrossed into the activity that you do that you forget your body, mind, time, surroundings, everything. But still you are there. You are performing an action. But while performing this action, you will not have a thought that you are coding. You are doing so and so, blah, blah. You keep on working on it. Look at designers. Look at the graphic designers and so many people who use their mental capabilities to create something. They were so engrossed into the activity that they will leave this idea of interruption, of I-ness here. I'm talking about the I-ness of the body. I am the body, I am doing this activity, I have the hands, mind, capability to do this, I will do that, I will. All this is silenced and only consciousness is working, and this consciousness is helping us create. So now you must understand that it is in fact the consciousness which is doing all these activities, but an agent who has arisen from this ability of consciousness in the state of jnana, because jnana is the state of intelligence. Human beings are intelligent beings and they have the capability to do anything, and this capability in the human beings is now waking up and claiming that it is doing all these things. So a separate identity, a mistaken identity is being born in this state of jnana, and by learning all these objects, by looking at these objects, and suppose if I am looking at a car, I say this is Skoda, this is so and so. So the objects are being now discriminated and identified by the vijnanam, by using the capability of intelligence. But you look at the previous state, all this vijnanam, jnanam subside in prajnanam. So the true meaning of prajnanam brahma is pure consciousness is parabrahman. So this particular state of prajnanam is a state which is beyond experience. It is an unbroken I-ness. You cannot say I achieved the state. You cannot say I saw it, because it is not an object to see. It is just an experience of I-ness, an unbroken I-ness which is beyond all this all. So whenever you do an activity, whenever you engage yourself in an activity, you will have the opportunity of identifying this prajnanam, which is the supreme power in all of us, in you. That is the true meditative state. That is called as trance. So this prajnanam, this pure consciousness, is untainted. Nobody can disturb it. It is just like a screen on which everything can be projected. You can do whatever you want on it. This is the true meaning of divinity. They say, this deity gives me power. This deity gives me the power of speech. This deity gives me the power of sight. This deity gives me the power of life. So these are all just concepts of our mind. this deity or the devata or the bhagavan whom we are telling, is this pure consciousness? You are confining yourself and you are telling that this can be done by this. So this is achieved by this. Man is attaching a cause and effect to everything. A cause and effect. When you go beyond cause and effect, you will understand that it is everything. All this is nothing but an act of this pure consciousness. But still, it is akarta abhokta. You cannot say it is doing, because only this agent has to arise and say that I did it. But who is this I? Transfer this identity to the pure consciousness and you will see that it is in fact the prajnanam which is doing all these things. So you are seeing this body, and that's the reason you say he did it, she did it, they did it. But who is doing inside? Consciousness is doing all these things. So when you understand Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi's answers very, very carefully, when you look at the state of the great masters, you will understand, you will realize that it is in fact the consciousness which is the supreme power in all of us. Look at Swami Vivekananda, who said, if you firmly deny poison, even poison cannot kill you. And look at the example of Matsyendranath, Goraknath, the Navanadhas. They proved. He drank boiling, liquid. But still, he was so safe. He was happy. He enjoyed that. He enjoyed that drink. But can you and me do that? So, from these experiences, you must understand that your mind has the capability of creating and denying. Your mind has the capability of doing anything in this universe. If you firmly believe that it is the supreme consciousness in all of us which is doing everything, which is the supreme power beyond all these activities of the world. So this differentiation in all of us should cease. We must understand that it is the pure consciousness which is giving me this energy to speak, to talk, to do. So the agent who is taking, who is grasping this energy from the pure consciousness, the substratum, is in fact creating all this nuisance. Because it's a wrong identity. Take another example. You take $1,000 from your father, go and give a party, your friends applaud you, and you say it's your praise. But whose money is it? Your father's money you are enjoying. Just like that. Take the example of a king. So, in same way, the supreme king in this body is in fact doing all these things. But you, who arose in between, is now claiming that all these are my actions. This is my greatness. I am doing all these things. I am the supreme power. So we must go beyond knowledge. We must go beyond jnana, the intelligence. And then only we will be able to understand the true nature, the truth about pure consciousness. Pure consciousness is untainted. It's unpolluted, unfathomable, unquenchable energy, which is all this all. Look at all this. For example, now, I look at an object and I say it is very hard. Or I touch this cloth and say it's very soft. I touch this steering and say it's hard. Who is telling this is soft? Who is telling this is hard? It is the consciousness helping us to do these differentiations, and it is the intermediary agent who is doing all these differentiations. So, who is telling that this object is like this, this object is like this? It is consciousness. When you closely understand the meaning of Dakshinamurti Stotra, I firmly believe every one of you will be able to understand the truth just like that. Because don't complicate things. Don't try to complicate things. Don't try to entangle things. Don't try to do all those confusions. Don't create confusions for yourself. Look at your consciousness. Look at the state of flow. Whenever you are working on your computer or whenever you are performing an action, when you have the ability of engrossing yourself into that activity, forgetting your body, your mind, your physical surroundings and everything, that is the opportunity, the moment of opportunity for you to realize who is working in this body. There is no I-ness there. There is no interruption. There is no obstruction. That is the state of flow. Now this guy Csikszentmihalyi, he is a foreigner. He is a behavioral scientist. He told us this theory. But the fate of Indians, you see, all these theories are in our Vedas and Upanishads. And because we don't know Sanskrit, because we didn't learn the mother language of our country, we now have to depend upon some foreigner to tell the things which are there inherent in our blood, which are there in our Shastras, which are there in our Upanishads and Vedas. The great seers proved it. This is the state of flow. And there are so many great achievements that you can do when you achieve this state of flow. When you don't interrupt this consciousness, it will do its action. That's what Bhagavan Ramana Maharshi says. Action happens automatically. It is only you who is disturbing it by your impurities, tainting with your thoughts, and you are disturbing that particular act. Whenever you are doing Homa, Yajna, Abhishekam, Archana, or any other Vedic prescribed rituals, your object is to achieve this state of flow. As long as you crib and cry about the objects that you are using and you get disturbed with your phone calls and all this stuff, it's better you don't do that. You don't even perform the ritual, because the prime purpose of performing these Vedic rituals is to help the person who is doing these activities achieve this state of flow and understand, realize the true power of this consciousness. But what we do? We put big speakers, we make a lot of noise, we disturb the silence, both external and internal. We crib, we cry, we shout, we create all sorts of nuisance and disturbance for us. And we say we performed Rudra Yaga, we performed Shatachandi Yaga, we performed that, we performed this. But only when you achieve that state of flow and in that particular state you offer those offerings to the fire god, that's when your Yajna is complete. And where are you offering this Purnahuti? It is not to the fire external. You must offer this Purnahuti to the fire within there, which is there inside you. These are the secrets. By means of external activities, rishis taught us how to achieve this state of flow inside. So all this discussion we started at this Mahavakya, Prajnanam Brahma. Pure consciousness is Parabrahman. So whenever you are engrossed, you are doing an activity. That's the reason rishis also say, engage yourself in an activity which you love the most. Because when you engage yourself in an activity which you love, which you earn, which you want to do in your life, that's when you will have the opportunity of putting your mind, body and soul into that activity, and you will achieve a state of flow. And that's the real tapasya. You don't need to do tapasya by sitting in forest caves, by shutting your room doors. No, tapasya happens automatically to a person who is doing his activity with complete attention and love. That is called as tapasya. Tapasya is the unbroken thought. Again, it is a thought, but this thought is unbroken. Unbroken, undeviated, uninterrupted flow of a particular thought will help you understand the true power of consciousness. So, I just wanted to, help the students of this generation to realize how much potential they have in them. forget about the people of yesterday. I'm not worried about those, because they have to do a lot of unlearning. Unlearning need to be done. But the boys of today, who don't know about scriptures, who don't know about Vedas, who don't know about Shastras, but they know about the power of this consciousness. They know the power of learning. They know the power of their own self. So just from there, you can realize who is the substratum of all this universe. That substratum, that principal lord of this universe, is sitting in your heart cave and giving you the energy to create. You are the creator of this universe. Please understand that. That's again a statement revealed by Swami Vivekananda. You are the creator of your destiny. But when you depend upon some other concept, some other theory, you are spoiling your capability, your true potential. So don't believe on some concepts. Don't believe the theories of fallacy. Don't depend on the dogmatic theories. Look at yourself, understand your true self, then you will see that it is the consciousness in fact doing all this. Every animal in this universe obeys the principle of this consciousness. Every animal knows where to go, what to do, how to find food, how to live. It is only the human being who will induce his own thoughts and disturb this nature's command, disturb this state of flow. And that's the reason why tapasya is only prescribed for the human beings. Animals don't need to do any tapasya because they are already in a state of flow. But they don't have this power of discrimination. They don't have the power of identifying what is good, what is bad, all this stuff. So, but I say, in fact, animals are very happy in this universe. It's only the human beings who are suffering with their own self-created problems of this ego. This intermediary agent is the ego, ahamkara. It says, I am, I am, I am. Who is this I am? When you look at Bhagavan Raman Maharshi's statement, he says that you remove this AM and it is only I which is remaining. I. In all of us, this is the I, the pure consciousness, the pure unbroken consciousness, the flow of this supreme energy, which is in fact the substratum of all this all, the Parabrahman. You don't have to give a name, you don't have to give a form, you don't have to create your own concepts of divinity. Forget about all that stuff. Rishis didn't prescribe this. Only for those people who are not capable of using their mental abilities and getting engrossed into that particular state of flow, require a form, require a name, require a mantra, require a ritual, require to do all these things. But why do you need all that stuff? You in fact are the conscious being. You are the consciousness. So remove this I am and just stick to this I. Achieve the state of flow. Do what you love. Fall in love with what you do. Throw yourself into that. Take that leap of faith. Mind, body and soul. And when you are performing an action, that's when you will understand the power of this Kriya Shakti which is there in you. So one must try to accomplish this state of flow. I thank this guy Sigzin, Mihal Sigzin, who introduced this beautiful concept, beautiful theory of flow to the rest of the world. But I regret that we Indians are not utilizing these Vedic sutras. By taking these concepts from Vedas and Upanishads, we depend upon some foreigner to come and teach us the stuff which is there in our Vedas. Youth of this India should understand that India is in itself is very rich in its knowledge, in its capability of intelligence and its accomplishments. Look at the life of great seers. Forget about gods. Look at seers. The great rishis are the gods. They in fact created all these things. So you must follow the path of the great seer who demonstrated and shown the power of that tempo, that perseverance, that unbroken attention, that dedication to unleash the real potential which is there in all of us. So I believe that we must all follow rishis. Just stop following these people who preach 100 different things. From morning till evening in TV, you see 100 different people teaching you 100 different things. And finally taking you to a state of analysis paralysis, where you become paralyzed. You will not do anything. You will only listen. Throughout your life, you keep listening to these people and say, oh, wow, this guy is telling too good. Oh, wow. This wow becomes your life. And you will not be able to achieve the state of wow, because you are depending, you are putting yourself in the hands of some person and saying that this guy is telling some good and I'll follow him. Follow yourself. Follow your inner voice. See the inner capability which is there in all of you. You don't need any concept. You don't need any theory to believe in you. You claim that you exist. Morning till evening, is there any moment that you are not there? You were there continuously. Then why do you need a concept to know about yourself? Why do you need a theory to know about yourself? Sit, question yourself, who am I? And the answer will come from within. And that answer is of not these words, but the answer is of silence. So try to achieve that inner silence and you will realize that you have great potential to do anything you want in this universe. So this Prajnanam Brahma is the Mahavakya which is taught to all of us by these Vedic seers, which says pure consciousness is pure Parabrahma. And I really wish the youth of this generation to utilize this capability which is there in them. Om Tat Sat.
Indro Vishvasya Rajati.